There you go.
All right. So as people are still coming in, I will get this presentation started. It is my distinct pleasure to introduce Dr. Jason Rosch for today's IGS seminar series. I'm Hervé Tetlin. I'm a professor in the Department of Microbiology and Immunology and the Institute for Genome Sciences at UMB School of Medicine. And let me tell you a little bit about Jason. He got his undergraduate degree from the College of Worcester and his doctoral degree in molecular microbiology and microbial pathogenesis from the Washington University in St. Louis. After that, he went to do a postdoc in the lab of Elaine Tuerman and at St. Jude Children's Research Hospital in Memphis, Tennessee. This is where he is currently as an associate member in the Department of Infectious Disease. Now, Jason is also affiliated with the University of Tennessee in the Department of Microbiology, Immunology, and Biochemistry, where he's a professor, as well as a member of their Center of Excellence for Pediatric Experimental Therapeutics. And I think that this last affiliation is really representative of what Jason's portfolio interests are. His research is dominated by finding therapeutic interventions, translational projects, including, for example, in the field of antibiotic resistance in the context of impaired immunity, which in a way is a really good fit for him being at St. Jude with these children who are being treated for cancer, and that lowers their immunity responses, and it causes all sorts of problems that I'm sure he's going to tell us about today. And the only other thing I'll do is highlight the fact that Jason has been incredibly productive in papers and research in the last couple of years. He published 12 papers this year alone, almost as many last year in really high profile journals. And I'll highlight just a couple. One was actually with Vaughan Cooper as a first author and Jason last author. Vaughan was a speaker in this series a few years ago when it was not virtual actually. And what they've done is they studied experimental evolution of pneumococcal communities during colonization in vivo. And that's another big strength of Jason's research portfolio, is that most of what he does is really in vivo. And I might have said in vitro, but I meant in vivo. And that's a really big plus, as we know, though. The only thing that's really relevant when you study host-pathogen interactions and trying to find ways to prevent diseases, to study things in vivo. And so that was a very beautiful study published in M Systems this year. And the other thing, you know, that Jason is really impressive with is you know, we know that the pneumococcal infection are exacerbated or much more severe when you've had the flu infection before that. And as far as I know, Jason is the first one that showed that not only do these two pathogens interact with the host, which we know, but they directly interact with each other. And he's got a beautiful series of experiments to demonstrate that these two, this virus and this bacterium, interact directly. And actually that interaction affects the way either of the two pathogens are transmitted, which I believe he's going to tell us about today as well. So with that, I'd like to ask everybody to feel free to post their questions in the chat during the presentation to save time at the end, but it's Jason's preference to tackle these questions at the end of his presentation. A reminder, this is being recorded, and the title of Jason's presentation today is Leveraging Bacterial Genetics to Understand Antibiotic Resistance and Transmission. There you go.
All right. Well, thank you very much for that fantastic introduction, as well as the invitation to speak and share some of our most recent data. Some of this is very much so works in progress, so I invite any critical feedback as well as any questions or comments at the end. Really would appreciate that. So I always like to start off my talks with a question that my mom asked me. And the question that she asks is, why do you study infectious disease? You're at St. Jude Children's Hospital. You're primarily a cancer hospital. There's two reasons for that. The first is that a lot of our kids, infections are very, very common in children with cancer. They require long-term chemotherapy as well as long-term antibiotic exposure as prophylaxis to prevent these infections. When they do get infections, these infections have a very high risk of recurrence. And death is actually a leading, death from infection actually accounts for 10 to 40% of all pediatric deaths in our leukemia patients. And we also think about the mission of St. Jude, that no child should die in the dawn of life. You really cannot do that without paying attention to infections. And specifically, we're really interested in bacterial pneumonias because these infections and pneumonias kill lots of kids worldwide every single year. So it's part of our mission to figure out ways to mitigate these infections. I'm going to talk about a couple different projects today. The introduction did a great job of telling you about some of the work that we've been doing. I'm going to talk a little about some of the new insights in viral bacterial co-infections between pneumococcus and influenza that we've been working on. Some of the work that we've been doing with transmission strategies of both bacterial and viral pathogens. And the way I'm going to start off this talk is asking the question is whether or not there's any host immune constraints on evolving antibiotic resistance. My lab primarily works with Streptococcus pneumoniae, but occasionally I get a knock on my door from a clinician with interesting clinical cases, and so we sometimes get involved in those. And this first case that I was going to talk about is actually with vancomycin-resistant enterococci, which is really a really resilient pathogen, and it's really of particular importance in our immune-compromised patients because we blast them with so many broad-spectrum antibiotics that a lot of times VRE is the last thing that's still colonized in the gut. And due to numerous antibiotic resistances, sometimes these infections can be very difficult to treat as they're resistant to many frontline antibiotics. The case that I got invited to participate in was a patient that was diagnosed with acute myeloid leukemia in early infancy and was immediately started on chemotherapy once they came here to St. Jude. Not unexpectedly, the chemotherapy resulted in severe neutropenia, so this patient had an undetectable absolute neutrophil count. And after 2 weeks of chemotherapy, the patient's peripheral blood smear revealed the presence of bacteria, and this ended up being VRE. This really wasn't that interesting, except for this infection lasted for 26 days. So this was a very, very prolonged bacteremia. And so up here, we just have the days of infection from 1 to 26. So this is a 26-day bacteremia in an 8-week-old infant. The blood culture was positive. And so we had I thought was the CBC might have been colonized with the bacteria. So that was removed. It was replaced 2 other times. So this patient had 3 CBCs in the course of this, and none of those 3 CBCs solved the problem. The really interesting thing was the antibiotic exposure this patient got. They were on vancomycin meropenem at first because we didn't know it was VRE. Once the clinical lab came back and indicated that it was VRE, it said it was susceptible to linezolid, daptomycin. So they immediately started the patient on linezolid. And about a week went by and the patient still hadn't cleared the bacterial infection. So the antibiotics were switched to daptomycin. The infection still did not clear. They added gentamicin in combination with the daptomycin. The infection still did not clear. They added linezolid in combination with daptomycin and gentamicin. The infection did not clear. And at this point, this patient was getting very, very sick. And so they started doing they took granulocytes from the parents. So they started to try to reconstitute the neutrophils. And so they got multiple granulocyte transfusions. You can see here the absolute neutrophil count starts to go back up. And at the end, it was a combination of linezolid, daptomycin, quinopristin, dalfopristin, and the granulocyte transfusion. And this patient was finally, we were able to eradicate this infection. So the question that we had was, why was this infection so hard to clear? And so what we did was we were able to collect every single one of these bloodstream isolates, and we sequenced all of these. And when we did this, my initial thought was we're going to see all these really cool mutations that were going to come up and come down in this population over time. But what actually occurred is we identified a single mutation that emerged on day 4 and persisted intermittently throughout the entire course of the antibiotic therapy. This mutation was in the hydrolase domain of a gene called RelA. So this is the molecular alarm system that's conserved amongst multiple bacterial species. Basically what this mutation does, in Enterococcus, the gene has both the hydrolase, so the breakdown activity, and the synthetase activity. And so when you have this mutation, this active site, you can make the alarmone, but you can no longer break it down. And this molecular alarmone controls a lot of different cellular processes involved in antibiotic tolerance, as well as adverse nutrient stress conditions, such as amino acid starvation, oxidative stress, and so on. Mutation had a pretty wishy-washy phenotype in the context of growing it planktonically. And so we can measure the levels of the alarmone with TLC. So we can look at the magic spots here, and we can see in the RelA mutant, you get elevated baselines of the alarmone. So it's almost sort of like it's primed to respond to adverse conditions. And it just increased it doubled to 2.5 increase in the amount of the alarmone. So that's kind of, it was interesting, but it really didn't like blow our hair back. And there was no really discernible impact of this mutation under any in vitro growth conditions. And the other thing that we noticed was there's no alterations in antibiotic susceptibility through standard testing. What we should note though is our standard testing methodology traditionally uses planktonic cells. So we asked the question, well, maybe the phenotype is not apparent planktonically, maybe it's apparent in a context of a biofilm. And so what we did here is we take these polystyrene pegs and we allow the bacteria to adhere to and grow in these pegs. We take these biofilm pegs and we put them into fresh media with various concentrations in the antibiotic and expose them for 24 hours. And then we take those pegs, wash them, and ask the question, does any of the biofilm cells survive that exposure? And this was actually really kind of cool because this mutation seemed to cause high-level resistance in the context of biofilm to multiple classes of antibiotics. And so what you see here in the black bars here is the wild-type bacterial strain. So this is the parental strain that does not have the RelA mutation. And then in red are two different isogenic RelA mutants that have that RelA mutation. And when you don't have any antibiotic, they both form biofilms basically the same, and they outgrow just fine. If you put VRE in a bath of 256 micrograms of per mil of vancomycin for 24 hours, you can actually kill it. But interestingly, the RelA mutants failed to be eradicated by this treatment. Most importantly, two of the frontline antibiotics that were used to treat this patient, linezolid and daptomycin, the original parental strain is highly susceptible to this, both planktonically and in the context of a biofilm. When you have the mutant there, these biofilms fail to be eradicated with either linezolid or daptomycin, showing complete treatment failure in the absence of a true resistance mechanism. And I like to just show this because this really surprised us. So this is just a single point mutation in the chromosome. But the transcriptional consequences of the single point mutation were really dramatic, especially in the context of the biofilm. The single point mutation caused altered regulation of up to over 10% of the transcriptome in the context of a biofilm when we assayed this. So this very, very small change in the stringent response really resulted in dramatic cellular consequences for this bacterium. And I like to say this did have a very happy ending. The patient survived, she's still in remission. And so that's a good happy ending at the end of the day. But this really led us to the question of asking, are there actual immune constraints on the emergence of antibiotic resistance? When we think about antibiotic resistance in the context of in vitro, the in vitro situation is very, very different than what happens in the body. The in vitro situation, you have defined nutrients, you have really fast, robust replication, and it's a really homogeneous niche. In healthy individuals, you have really complex and diverse nutrient sources depending on what tissue you're infecting. You have much slower bacterial replication. The niches are more heterogeneous, so the niche of the nasal passages is different than the lungs, it's different than the blood. And in most healthy individuals, you have additional pressure from the innate immune system that is actually clearing out the bacteria. We think that the immune compromised host exists somewhere in between these two spectrums. The reason for this is you tend to have higher bacterial burdens and faster replication speed, mostly because the depleted immune system fails to clear the bacteria. And the depleted immune system may also allow for less fit mutational variants to both emerge and prolong stay as a prolonged infection in these hosts. So the question that we had is whether or not experimental evolution could be applied to in vivo challenge models. The way we do this sort of in vitro is we do serial passages in test tubes with media, where you increase the antibiotic concentration, and typically what you see is an increase in bacterial antibiotic resistance. Very straightforward. The questions we had, well, is applying this in vivo even feasible? If we can actually get it to work, is it reproducible? And even if it's reproducible, are we going to get anything useful out of it? And so what we did here is we did a nasal colonization model just in mice. So what we do is we colonize mice with Streptococcus pneumoniae for 3 days. After 3 days, we harvest the bacterial populations and we use those to infect the next mouse, and we also sequence those populations. So it's feasible. The other thing that came out from these studies is also very, very highly reproducible. So in the panels to the right here, this is an example. So these are three different mouse lineages across 10 generations. In all lineages, we get this DLTB mutant that's under fairly strong selective pressure. So in this lineage, it gets up to almost 90% of the lineage and ends up losing to this mutant right here. Again, in the second lineage, the DLTB mutant does really quite well, and it gets outcompeted by this same mutation in this transcriptional regulator that ends up dominating the population. And then this lineage three, the DLTB does pretty well. It gets up to 50%, but the early emergence of this regulator basically dominates the population. We can see how these various genotypes emerge with these various Mueller plots. And so we can sit here and track these genotypes over time and what proportion they are of the population. And then the question was whether or not this was actually informative. And one of the mutations that was under very, very strong selective pressure was a mutation that causes a loss of function in this gene called DLTB. So this is involved in the surface charge of the surface decoic acids of pneumococcus. So when you delete this gene, the surface charge of the pneumococcus becomes more negatively charged. And we do competitive indexes with the parental strain and this mutant in a 50-50 ratio. The mutant ends up winning and dominating most of the population. So this, I believe this was five independent lineages and ends up dominating the population. Even when it emerges as only 10% of the initial population, within three passages, it ends up being 3/4 of the population. So when you, there's very, very strong selective pressure to lose this gene in the population during colonization. So we can see this in the nasal washes where you delete the gene and we see a fitness benefit in the nasal passages. And the question is, well, why does pneumococcus keep this gene around if it's so advantageous to lose it? And the reason for that is that the loss of this gene imparts a very strong fitness benefit during colonization, but during lung disease, we actually see a very strong fitness trade-off. So strain becomes hyper susceptible to antimicrobial peptides. And so when there's actually a lot of inflammation going on, such as what you have during a bacterial pneumonia, the fitness benefit of the strain is abrogated and actually becomes a negative fitness benefit. So in the context of antimicrobial peptides, this has a fitness trade-off. So the question that we really wanted to get to for this is asking whether this experimental evolution can be applied to understand how antibiotic resistance evolves. And our hypothesis for this project is that the evolutionary trajectories of antibiotic resistance can actually be constrained by host immunity. So what we'd anticipate is that what the evolutionary pathways of resistance that we observe in vitro, either in planktonic or in biofilm, would not be the same as what we'd see in the immunocompromised host, and the immunocompromised host would be distinct from the healthy individuals. And so we were hoping what we would see is we'd see these distinct evolutionary strategies to deal with antibiotic stress under these various conditions. So this is what we've been doing for the last couple of years now. So what we do is we have a founder population of Streptococcus pneumoniae, and we established three independent mouse lineages. So we have just plain old healthy biopsy mice. We have mice where we deplete the pulmonary macrophages with clodronate liposomes. And then we have neutrophil depleted animals that we deplete with cyclophosphamide. So we have two immune deficient conditions. We infect these mice and we allow them to become very, very sick. So approximately 10 to 12 hours post-challenge, we give them a subtherapeutic antibiotic treatment. So this is designed to eliminate approximately 90 to 99% of the bacteria that's in the lungs at that time. After the treatment, we wait another 12 hours. We harvest the lungs. We collect the bacterial populations. We fully sequence these populations. We get the MICs for the respective antibiotics. And we repassage these 10 to 30 times. So this ends up being a lot of data. And so this is what we've done so far. And we actually have a couple more that we can add to this list now. But we've done a lot of work with cell wall active antibiotics. So we've done this with penicillin, inupenem, meropenem, vancomycin, cefepime, amoxicillin, ampicillin, and cefotriaxone. And so for a lot of these, we have anywhere from 15 passages, which is equivalent to 135 genomes from these studies. We've done antibiotics that target the ribosome, linezolid, clindamycin, azithromycin. We've gone after the fluoroquinolones with ciprofloxacin and levofloxacin, as well as drugs that target the RNA polymerase rifampin. So this is currently well over 2,000 murine passages. So you can imagine this is a fair amount of work. We have over 2,000 population profiles of pneumococcus at over 100-fold depth. For each one of these population passages, we do variant calling and prevalence using BreeSeq. We have antibiotic susceptibility, bacterial burden, and some really tired researchers in the lab. But we get some very interesting data out of this. And one of the things I just want to underscore is this is just a couple examples of what we see. This is an example with using either cefepime or levofloxacin using neutrophil depleted animals, macrophage depleted, or non-depleted animals. When we first started this passaging, for cefepime, we're using 1 mg/kg, which is usually quite effective at clearing the infection or reducing the bacterial burden quite a bit. And for levo, we're using 25 mg/kg. By the end of these experiments, we've gone up 15-fold for the cefepime. So 15 mg/kg would completely wipe out the parental strain. But by the end of these experiments, we're seeing complete antibiotic treatment failure. We see this across the board with another example would be levofloxacin. We started off at 25 mg/kg was an effective dose. And by the end of the experiments, we're going up to 200 mg per kilogram and seeing complete antibiotic treatment failure. But the really interesting thing is, even though we've escalated these antibiotic dosages this high in these cases, we still do not traditionally, we do not see, for the most part, big shifts in MIC by traditional testing. What we do see is a high level of antibiotic tolerance. So this is just an example from the levofloxacin passaged isolates. So we treat the parental strain with levofloxacin, we get a rapid decline in bacterial viability. So we lose approximately 2 logs over the course of 4 hours. And then with the in vivo evolved isolates, when we treat them with the same concentration of antibiotics, despite having the exact same MIC, we see much reduced kill kinetics. And this just keeps going on for a number of hours. So these bugs have, even though they have not evolved resistance, they figured out ways to tolerate the antibiotics and basically become professional persisters or tolerant organisms. Working with Von Cooper and Shelley Schreiber, who's a graduate student in his lab, we've been looking at the population profiles of these passages. And this is just a allele frequency plot of what we sort of see. This is a little bit confusing, but I'll try to walk you through it. So here in pink is a mutation that emerged very early and ended up winning and becoming fixed in the population. At generation 5, you can see these three mutations that emerge and end up doing very, very well in the population up to about generation 15. And this is when we started bumping up the antibiotic dose in this animal. So right at this point, we doubled the antibiotic dose, and these genetic mechanisms for dealing with the antibiotics are no longer effective here. So these mutations crash out of the population, these new mutations arise, which then do okay until we raise the antibiotic dosage again, and then these crash out, and then we get other mutations that arise here, and these ones actually end up getting close to fixed in the population at these increase in dosages. And then we also still see these minor variants that end up being, they never go to fixation, but they always, there's a constant selection for them to be maintained at between 25 and 50% of the population. And when we map these variants across the various immune deficiencies, it's really kind of fun because we can find some mutations that are shared across all lineages. So ones that are shared in the macrophage depleted, the neutrophil, and the wild type lineages. So we get mutations, we get our on-target mutations in our penicillin binding proteins, which makes sense because that's the on-target mutation. But it's really interesting because, for example, in the macrophage depleted lineages, we get very specific mutations that only arise in the macrophage depleted lineage that do not arise in the neutrophil or wild type lineages. Likewise, in the neutrophil depleted animals, we get mutations that are respond to these antibiotics specifically only in the context of impaired immunity. And then we have these wild type mutations that emerge in the wild type animals that never undergo strong selection in the context of impaired immunity, which we think is really, really interesting. So we can stratify these mutations by immune pressure. And the key for this is we can find on-target mutations sometimes, but a lot of times these antibiotic tolerance and persistence mechanisms are these off-target mutations that seem to be conferring these antibiotic treatment failure phenotypes. I sort of went through that a little bit quick, but the key things I want you to take away from those studies is that the pathways to antibiotic resistance, especially in vivo, are really complicated. They involve multiple mutations in a mixed populations, at least in vivo. Our in vivo passaging results in treatment failure and complete absence of antibiotic resistance. And we really believe that tolerance is really the primary mechanism behind this. And we think this is because, as opposed to what you see in vitro conditions, in vivo you get a constant antibiotic flux based on the pharmacokinetics of the antibiotics. And some of the data I showed you is these immune compromised lineages really encode different mutations in response to antibiotic pressure. Switching over a little bit to more of my bread and butter of the lab is Streptococcus pneumoniae pathogenesis. It's really fun working with the pneumococcus because it can really cause a lot of damage to the human body depending on where it ends up. Pretty much everybody on this call has been colonized at one time or another in their lifetime, and quite a few of you are probably colonized right now. The pneumococcus readily transmits between people and recolonizes. And most of the time this is completely asymptomatic and does not cause a problem. It's when it gets into the host niches that it's not supposed to be in that it can really sort of wreak havoc. It's a leading cause of acute otitis media in young children. We were very interested in bacterial pneumonia, so when it translocates into the lung, it causes some severe lung disease. It can translocate into the bloodstream and cause bacteremia and sepsis. It's one of the few pathogens that can cross the blood-brain barrier and cause bacterial meningitis. And some work that Carlos at UAB has done, he's done some really elegant work showing that pneumococcus can translocate into the heart and causes cardiac lesions, causing cardiac complications following bacterial pneumonias, which is both scary and fascinating. And there are certain strains that actually can cause ocular infections with periodic outbreaks of these non-encapsulated strain backgrounds. So it can really infect a really diverse set of host tissues, which is very interesting. And a lot of our understanding of how these, why pneumococcus is so successful in these tissues is we've had the benefit of really nice, elegant virulence factor screens for a lot of these host niches. So we know what pneumococcal genes are involved in bacteremia, so we know what it needs to survive in the blood. We've done some work showing that what it needs to translocate into the middle ear. We know what genes are required for bacterial pneumonia and meningitis, as well as for colonization. But one of the big holes that's been in the field is we don't really know a lot of the mechanisms for how it transmits from host to host. And this is actually a really, really critical driver of pneumococcal fitness. And the way that I think about this, and I was introduced to this concept by Jeff Weiser, is invasive disease is really an evolutionary dead end, because it either the body either clears the infection with antibiotics or your immune system, or it's a dead host. And both those are evolutionary dead ends for the pneumococcus. And it's a fairly complex process for the bug, because it has to be able to stick into environment, proliferate in that environment, sense some sort of environmental signal to release and pack up shop, survive in that environment again, and then stick into a new host. And so the question that we had are, what are the mechanisms underlying pneumococcal transmission? And the reason, so we set this up, we set up a ferret model of pneumococcal transmission. We were a little bit crazy trying to start this. The rationale for doing this is the infant mouse model of pneumococcal transmission has very, very constrained population bottlenecks, which are not necessarily amenable to high throughput screens. And so we decided to see if we could get this to work in context of ferrets. About 10 years ago, there was a paper by John McCullers and Brigida Henriks-Normark demonstrating that ferrets transmit pneumococci by both contact-dependent and airborne routes. And the bacterial loads in both the donors and the contacts, especially in the context of influenza co-infection, in theory should be high enough for genome-wide screens. And so we decided to give this a shot. And so the way we experimentally set this up, we did this based on contact-dependent transmission. The airborne transmission events were, the bottlenecks are too constrained to set this up appropriately. So what we have is donor and recipient ferrets. So for each donor ferret, we have 2 to 3 recipient ferrets. Each of these ferrets get influenza. So this is an H3N2 CD97 strain of influenza. So this allows us to open up the population bottlenecks even more. And then 3 days after flu co-infection, we hit them with their a serotype 19F TN-seq library of pneumococcus. And then for 3 days after this challenge, we collect sneezes from the donors and the ferret animals. And then at day 4, we collect the tissues. And from each of these sneeze recoveries and the tissue recovery, we harvest the entire TN-seq library. We submit it through the standard workflows and sequence them. And basically what we came up with was a really nice map of the pneumococcal genes required for ferret transmission. In red are all the genes that are predicted to have a defect in transmission. So we pick up a lot of genes involved in carbohydrate metabolism, nucleic acid metabolism, which makes sense because you have to be able to undergo metabolism to survive and colonize a new host. We get these hypotheticals, unknowns that nobody's worked with. We get a lot of bacteriocin and phage elements, which is really quite interesting that these have a role during transmission. Competence in DNA repair, when you delete the competence machinery in pneumococcus, these bugs fail to transmit. We get a number of surface proteins, so we get complement degraded protease, some choline binding proteins, a lot of transcriptional regulators. We get cellular transporters, again, involved in metabolism, so some peptide transporters, carbohydrate transporters, some of unknown substrate, as well as some metal transporters. And then we had 2 mutants that actually ended up being hypertransmissible. So these 2 mutants ended up in 100%, transmitted in 100% of the animals. These genes are SPXB, so the pneumococcal pyruvate oxidase. And this gene here is the transcriptional regulator of SPXB, SPXR. So they sort of phenocopy each other. So it was kind of nice to see those both pop up in the screen like that. But one of the things we're really interested in is developing therapeutics based on these basic research findings. So the question that we had is, well, we know these transmission factors are. Can we actually leverage these as an effective vaccine strategy? And so what we did is we picked a couple of our surface-anchored transmission factors. We vaccinate female mice. We boost and mate them at week 3 and 5. And then at week 6, the pups are born, and we infect half the litter to see if maternal vaccination can block pneumococcal transmission. So when we vaccinate the mothers, the 3 vaccines we had in these conditions were the alum, which is our negative control, PIA and CPPA are two transmission factors found in the screen, and PCV13 is our capsule-based screen. When you vaccinate the mothers with any of these antigens, we do not impact donor colonization at all, so this does not impact bacterial burden in the donor animals. What's interesting is what happens with the contact animals. And so over here, this reads as percent uncolonized. So in our alum control, we get about 90% of the animals transmit, so only 10% remain uncolonized by the end of the 12 or 14 day period. We get a little bit of protection against PCV with PCV13. I think if we did this again, we might be able to get this to be significant, but it really wasn't that strong of a phenotype in our hands. Conversely, when we vaccinate with either this transmission factor or this transmission factor, we get a really nice robust protection against donor to contact transmission. So this is really kind of interesting because it really indicates that we could cripple transmission really by targeting these transmission factors. And the other thing I was going to mention, all these experiments were done in the context of influenza co-infection. So we had to do this for a number of reasons, mostly to open up the population bottlenecks. And Streptococcus pneumoniae and influenza really are a deadly combination of two pathogens. They're really very fascinating. Co-infection with influenza, when you have an influenza co-infection, the bacterial density in the nasal passages can be enhanced dramatically up to 100-fold. You can have much longer carriage duration when you have influenza co-infection. Transmissions enhanced, we see this both in Jeff Weiser's murine model as well as ferret models of transmission. When you have influenza co-infection, you actually have enhanced susceptibility to acute otitis media and increased incidence. And it also dramatically increases the incidence of both bacterial pneumonias and invasive disease susceptibility. So it's a really nasty combination of pathogens. And aspect that we just recently figured out, it all started off when we started looking at ferret sneezes from these transmission experiments. So on the left panels here are pneumococcus that's stained in green with 19F capsular antibodies, and then red is the influenza A virus nucleoprotein. And what we really saw was that these clumps of bacteria that look like they're coming out like in these nasty biofilm clumps are absolutely loaded with viral antigen on the surface. And we were just really fascinated by this because this is really sort of the last thing I expected to see from this material. And just based on looking at these pictures, I just asked my postdoc, Hannah Rowe, well, maybe the simplest explanation is what's happening. Does the flu virus directly bind to the bacteria? And if it does this have any fitness consequences? This is actually not too crazy. Julie Pfeiffer's done a lot of this work with enteric viruses and enteric pathogens, demonstrating, there's a really nice cell host microbe paper 2 years ago, demonstrating viral binding on the bacterial surface. And there was some work done 10 or 20 years ago looking at the binding of RSV virus to the surface of Streptococcus pneumoniae. So it's not that crazy of an idea that there could be direct interactions between pneumococcus and influenza. So we have really easy experimental setup for this. We basically mix influenza and pneumococcus for 30 minutes in vitro. We do a differential centrifugation step to get the bacterial pellet and wash it to get rid of any weakly associated virus. And then we see how much virus sticks. We use microscopy and we do some adherence assays and some in vivo studies. And it's really kind of nice because it really appears that pneumococcus binds influenza quite effectively in vitro. We can measure this by TCID50 as well as by QRT-PCR. We can see this by microscopy. We can also do this by flow cytometry. So this is two different strains of pneumococcus, a serotype 19F and a serotype 2. And usually about 5 to 10% of the bacterial population will come up positive for influenza virus. And I also want to point out in the same article that we agreed to publish side to side with this lab from Australia, they see the same thing and they actually replicated our flow cytometry results and they actually have really nice EMs. So if you're interested in following up with this, this is actually a really excellent manuscript examining the immune consequences of this direct interaction. This interaction really has some nice benefits for the pneumococcus. when you have influenza in complex with the bacterial surface, you get a dramatic increase in bacterial adhesion to epithelial cells. If you just do a co-infection with them not complex, you don't see the synergy. So the complex really seems to drive the synergy. This is strain and serotype independent. We see this for Tiger 4, D39, and this BHN97 strain. We also see this with, to a somewhat lesser extent, to nasopharyngeal cells, whereby the complex seems to stick better. So when you coat the bacterial surface with this virus particle, it's almost like coating the bacteria with Velcro and helps you stick to these host cells. This also promotes tissue tropism in vivo. So when you make these complexes and put them when you put these complexes in during infection, you see a nice little boost in colonization. You also see this during translocation into the middle ear. So if you have them in complex with each other, they're much more efficient at going from the nasal passages into the middle ear. It also actually promotes more severe invasive disease. And so when we have the bacterium complex with the virus, we kill approximately 95% of the animals. If you just have D39 and the virus just co-infected, so without complex formation, it's closer to an LD50. So we really think these complexes have important complex or important consequences at the host pathogen interface. It also seems to associate with other bacteria. We can see this with Staph, aureus, Moraxella, and Haemophilus. We do this by microscopy as well as by TCID50 as well as by flow cytometry. This is kind of a cool video, hopefully it'll play. This is structured illumination microscopy. And so in green is the pneumo and staph, and you can see these two little red virus particles that pop up on the bacterial surface. And so we're getting really quite good at actually getting to the point where we could image these viral particles on the surface with super resolution microscopy. And as I just mentioned, this seems to hold true for multiple bacterial species. Some bacteria do it better than others. Moraxella and pneumococcus do it quite well. There's strains of E. coli that really don't bind it at all. We can measure this again by flow cytometry, where we see anywhere from about 5% of Staph aureus to up to 15% of Haemophilus bind influenza to the surface. So basically, influenza seems to adhere to many respiratory colonizers and pathogens. And the adherent influenza virus on the bacterial surface really enhances adherence to multiple nasopharyngeal epithelial cells for multiple strains of bacteria. We think this may hold true for other viruses. As I mentioned before, folks have seen this with RSV. We've done this, examined this just with the COVID spike protein. And here on the panels on the left, this is just in green is Staph aureus, and the red is the COVID spike protein, and we could see the COVID spike protein binding quite well to the surface of Staph aureus. We can also see this via Western blot against the spike, where we have the spike being pulled down with Streptococcus pneumoniae Staph aureus. Maybe not so well with Pseudomonas. We've been having troubles with this. I'm not sure this one is real here, because when we dilute it out, we really don't see that. But it seems to adhere really quite well to Staph aureus, pneumococcus, and Haemophilus. We think this may be applicable to other respiratory viruses. But the big question that we had from this was, all that I've talked about so far is the benefits all been on the bacterial side of things. So could this potentially have some sort of benefit to influenza virus? So influenza is really not all that stable in the environment, but the pneumococcus really is. It's able to survive really extensive dehydration stress and retain both viability and infectivity. And so we asked the question as well, could this interaction with pneumococcus enhance environmental stability of influenza? So again, this is a pretty easy setup. So we just bind the virus to the surface of the bacteria. And then we have these bacterial-associated virus particles, and then we have just our unbound virus. And we basically put this into a speed vac and dry it down, and then we throw it in a drawer for 24 to 72 hours. And we titer how much virus is left, and we call this the desiccation-resistant virus titer. This is pretty cool because this is our input virus. So this is how much virus in blue is bound to the pneumococcal surface in these experiments. So we have about a 5 log TCID50. When you take that same amount of virus and you desiccate it down, pretty much you lose viability immediately. So we see about a 3-log reduction in bacterial viability following desiccation. If you do this in complex with the bacteria, you completely rescue viral viability. And you can take these desiccated viruses that are in complex with the bacteria, throw them in a drawer for 48 hours, and you don't see any loss in influenza infectivity, which we think was pretty interesting. The really cool thing here is that the binding and stabilizing the virus are two independent events. So the only two bacterial species that seem to really do well at stabilizing influenza A virus, pneumococcus does it very well. Staph is maybe, but not really well. Staph epidermis does not stabilize at all, even though it binds it equivalently. Moraxella stabilizes it. Haemophilus, even though it's a really good influenza A binder, does not stabilize the virus. And this is a non-encapsulated strain of Haemophilus. And Pseudomonas, even though it binds it, does not stabilize at all. So adherence and stabilization are completely distinct events. The stabilization for the pneumococcus seems to require the polysaccharide capsule. It's at least partially dependent upon it. So we delete the polysaccharide capsule from these strains. We get about a 1 to 2 log reduction in the viral stabilization, which sort of makes sense because you're talking about a really nice hydrated carbohydrate structure on the bacterial surface that this virus is pretty much embedded in. And again, with the non-typeable Haemophilus, we can actually see a nice little bump in viral stability when we use an encapsulated form of Haemophilus. We think the primary stabilization mechanism is this polysaccharide capsule of these bugs. So this led us to think, well, if influenza A virus is protected from desiccation viability by binding these respiratory bacterial species that you find in your respiratory tract, and we know that environmental stability can impact viral transmission, the question that we had is, well, does the resident bacterial flora have any impact in influenza A virus transmission? So what we do here is, again, we turn to our ferret model for transmission experiments. So this is now airborne-based transmission where the ferrets are separated by a screen here. What we have are donor and aerosol contact ferrets. In some of these cases, we decolonize the nasal bacteria by topical treatment with mupirocin for donors' aerosol contacts. So in some animals, we just hit the donors, and then we have controls where there's no treatment or just vehicle treatment. So at day minus three, we treat the animals with mupirocin. We do it again 48 hours later. And then we treat the donors and contact animals again. We challenge with Calio-9 influenza A virus. Days 3, 5, 7, and 9, we collect sneezes and continue mupirocin treatment. And day 20 or 21, we collect serum to measure for seroconversion. So in the situation for our control animals where they just get influenza A virus and there's no mupirocin depletion, we get about 2/3 the animal to 3/4 transmitting. So the donor animals have reasonably high viral titers. In the aerosol contacts, we pick up virus by TCID50 as well as by seroconversion. When we treat both the donor and the aerosol contacts with mupirocin, the donor animals still get very nice high viral titers here in black. 100% of the donor animals seroconvert, but the aerosol contacts in this situation completely fail to seroconvert. So we had 0 out of 5 animals have detectable virus in the situation, and none of them seroconverted. I should also mention these are younger ferrets that are traditionally used in a lot of influenza transmission experiments. These were only about 8 weeks old, and the reason for that is a lot of our preliminary data, the younger ferrets tend to transmit bacterial species a lot better than the older ferrets for unknown reasons right now. The key for this is we could actually take, we had a strain of pneumococcus that we made mupirocin resistant. So we could take these donor animals that have been completely depleted of the respiratory flora and then add back pneumococcus and ask the question, well, does it restore transmission? So again, in the donor animals in black, we get robust viral replication in the donors and 100% of them seroconvert. When we add back the pneumococcus, now we get 100% transmission as measured by both TCID50 as well as by seroconversion. So I think this is really kind of cool. And then we think this is a really nice example of a dual pathogen synergy that's really mutually beneficial to each pathogen. On the side of the pneumococcus, we get enhanced adherence to respiratory cells. We get enhanced colonization and progression to otitis media, as well as enhanced transmission. On the virus side of things, we think that the certain bacterial species in the respiratory tract can actually help the influenza virus with environmental stability. The stability seems to require the pneumococcal polysaccharide capsule, at least in the case of influenza A virus. And our data suggests that the respiratory bacterial flora is really an important aspect of promoting airborne influenza A virus transmission. And I threw a lot of data out at you, so I also have to send out a lot of thanks to a lot of the people that do this work. Hannah Rowe did all the influenza co-infection work, which is a lot of what I talked about today, and that's all been done in collaboration with Stacy Schultz-Cherry, who's my partner in crime on these. A lot of the antibiotic evolution experiments have been done by Enoli Amar, Jordan Coggins, Tina Dow, and Andy Nishimoto. I have collaborations actively in Department of Infectious Disease Animal Resource Center. A lot of the antibiotic evolution experiment is part of a big research team that we have between Tufts with Ralph Isberg, Boston College with Tim, University of Pittsburgh with Vaughn, and some other data that I did not talk about. I've got lots of collaborators and great projects going on. Did not have time to talk about all of them. And of course, the funding support, without which we would not be able to do some of these pretty cool experiments. I'd be more than happy to take any questions or comments from anybody. Thank you very much for listening.